On behalf of RIT Advisory Alumni Hub and Global Association for Corporate Services, I welcome all of you to the second webinar arranged by RA Hub. Thank you very much indeed for joining today. We have Gaurav Somvanshi to talk to us today about importance of LinkedIn in our professional life. Ra has been working on this particular aspect of creating necessary awareness on various aspects in professional life for all of us. And we have concluded yesterday our 11th meeting, weekly meeting. During all those meetings, we have been talking about various initiatives, and I'm sure you all are following us on our LinkedIn page as well as our Facebook page and aware of all such initiatives. While talking to various alumni and stakeholders, right from institution, undergraduates, we realize that we need to really work hard on this particular aspect of our social media, especially professional social media. And therein, we need to really give attention to LinkedIn. So today, we have invited my great friend, Mr. Gaurav Somvanshi. Before we start, I would like to give you just simple instructions. Please do not unmute yourself, which will create unnecessary trouble to others. I will not be able to receive the speaker's voice clearly. Please switch off your camera in case you are not getting proper reception. It will improve your bandwidth. Please free to ask questions to Gaurav. We will try to take these questions at the end of the sessions. Please type these questions at in chat section. I will request all of you to refrain from chatting the unnecessary messages on chat, because otherwise we will miss some important questions. The session is going to run from 5 to 6, as I told you. In case it gets interrupted because of any technical reason, please join the meeting again on the same coordinates. I request you to please follow us on RA Facebook page as well as LinkedIn page. And this recording will be made available on YouTube channel of GSCS as well as YouTube channel of RA. Now I will very quickly introduce Gaurav. Gaurav is the CEO and co-founder of Emertech Innovations, and he's graduate from IIM Lucknow and a computer engineer from Aurangabad. Gaurav was also selected as a future leader by British Council and has presented his work in UK Parliament in House of Lords and House of Commons, along with University of Cambridge. He has also conducted blockchain workshops in Washington and in Jackson, Mississippi. He has also conducted workshops for IAS officers of NCR government, ISB Hyderabad, IIM Bangalore, and other colleges. Gaurav is also an associate editor at the Switzerland-based academic journal Frontiers in Blockchain and heads the section of blockchain for fair equity in agriculture. I'm personally working with Gaurav at Sahyadri Farms on this particular aspect of blockchain and fair equity in agriculture. He has worked extensively with state of Chhattisgarh, where he conducted the state's first pilot using blockchain and e-governance, land record management, health record management, and other use cases. These are all direct payment benefit cases. He also conducted this state government's first ever blockchain hackathon and is a member of Africa Blockchain Alliance. He co-authored a thought paper with Special Secretary Mr. Alex Paul Menon, who is incidentally his mentor, that outlined how blockchain can change e-governance. His personal project of conducting technology workshops for audience across India has also earned him selection as a Dalai Lama Fellow this year, where he presented his work at University of Virginia in June. In fact, he told me last entire week he's been busy with those meetings, because this time he could not travel to US. and those sessions are happening right now on online platform. Currently, he's working with my great friend, Mr. Vilas Shinde, chairman of Sahyadri Farms, which is India's largest farmer collective, to develop a blockchain solution that can help the farmers. I would like, Gaurav, if possible, at last, if you can talk in between also for 2 minutes on this particular project. He's also a social activist, writer, and independent researcher. His ongoing weekly article series in Lok Satta, which is right now going on blockchain, Sakhalicha Swatantra, is a very famous and getting overwhelming response from the readers. I think before we go, I have a very interesting video, and that video will again give you in-depth introduction of our today's speaker. Please watch this 3.5 minutes video. You will really like him. I think you are not able to see. Just give me one.
Completely confident about your field of work, so that it slowly translates into self-confidence, which turns into conviction. The most important, the key thing that I've learned over here during my time is to be completely confident about your field of work, so that it slowly translates into self-confidence, which turns into conviction, which makes it easier for others to believe in you. The value of meeting different people from such different backgrounds working in different fields is that you get to understand the different challenges that each and everyone is facing. And through that, you also learn to have empathy, and your horizons of thinking are also broadened. Having such an amazing network of people and leaders all across the world is useful for me. It's very crucial for me, because now I can reach out to them for help, for advice, and also for possible advocacy. I'm Gaurav Somvanshi. I come from India. For the first 21 years of my life, I have lived in a small city in somewhere in western Maharashtra called Aurangabad. It's famous because of its proximity to the Buddhist caves, which are like 25 to 3000 years old. And since then, after the age of 21, I've been living in different parts of this country and working in diverse sectors. I believe the primary reason that I've been chosen is because the success that I've had in introducing blockchain to Chhattisgarh. Because what I did primarily was to reach out to global experts, convince them on my own that you can work here and it is worth the effort, and do it all on their own expenses because we are lacking resources. And they did come, they did help, and we did complete some successful projects which have been first of its kind in India. When it comes to inspirations, I have had many, but if I have to name just one, I would say it would be the architect of the Indian Constitution, Dr. Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar, because although he came from a very marginalized and oppressed background, he single-handedly led the entire struggle for education and for people to get their human rights. And it has been such an amazing lesson that I can draw from his life, that I feel if I could just emulate him to just 1%, then I would have made it really big.
Hello everyone. So this is the last day in Cambridge at the Mauler Institute, and half of us have left and half of us are just waiting to leave in some time. The past few days have been really an overwhelming experience, and I'm feeling sad and happy at the same time. A part of me will always be here at the Mauler Institute, but in return I think I'm also taking something along with me back to India when I go back.
If I have to summarize my experience over the past 10 days, I could probably do it in 3 ways. So my intellect, it is so positively challenged by the interactions I had at the parliament. My mind at this moment, it is so heavily filled with the questions that were posed to us by the elders. But to be honest, if I seek deep into my soul, I'm completely overwhelmed by the emotion that I have to say goodbye to 49 other amazing colleagues who have now become my family. I got to meet 49 of some of the most amazing people all around the world. And initially it was all about discussing ideas about policy visions, but when it came to evening, it was all about what you feel as a person, what are your past experiences. And it was a gelling of the intellect and the heart at the same time. And I don't know how you can say goodbye to a bond like that, but I know that we are going to stay together, because we are not just now future leaders group or a cohort. Right now I think we are a family.
Someplace. We'll definitely be back.
So I think I hope we were able to hear the entire conversation and that video clearly. With this, I hand over entire control to my great friend Gaurav. Over you, Gaurav. Hello. Rohit, we can hear you something. Gaurav, can you? Okay, I'll unmute you.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
That was really an overwhelming introduction, but that was just the front end, as I'd like to say. The back end is a lot more, so rather simple and down to earth, which I would like to present. So one very easy thing that usually happens when we begin with such introductions is that people feel that there was something special beforehand which led to these achievements, but that is not at all the case. In fact, that is why I myself am eager to share my experience regarding what actually helped me, how this came about to be, because as you'll see through the presentation, it's something that anyone can do. It's just a matter of knowing how to do it. And rather than just saying, although yes, the full session will be focused upon LinkedIn, but before that, I'll just share my screen, if that's okay, Ava sir.
Yeah, please share.
Yes. So one important thing that is very necessary to understand is that LinkedIn skills falls under another umbrella, a much larger concept. That concept needs to be clear. That is something that I've learned from many people, majorly from you, Baba Sahib, because you did networking. That is why I am now connected with Vilas sir, and that's why I'm no more working in Chhattisgarh, but now I'm working for this blockchain project. So what is essentially networking is, I love these two quotes. So networking is simply starting a conversation and you don't have a destination in mind. So at this point, daily, I'll just give you an example. What does this mean? So today, Sayadri Farms is printing close to 20,000 QR code labels, which will be given on each and every food packet with full transparency of agriculture value chain. That is the project. But exactly 1 year ago, was this something that Aba Sahib or me had in mind when we just connected in Santa Cruz at a function? No, that is not why you do networking, where you want to achieve a certain specific goal. Of course, you want to work together, you have expertise. So that's why it's already narrowed down. It's not like having a friendship. So, but it also means that you keep it open-ended to a certain extent. And the second is, networking is not collecting contacts. And that's also very important, that it doesn't matter. So yes, we did brag about that I have 16,000 connections, but the number doesn't matter, because I have seen people with 1,000 contacts, but they are in touch with every one of them. I have seen people with 30,000 connections, but hardly any meaningful interaction over there happens. So networking is about, as the quote says, planting relations. And a professional career has to be seen in a much larger ambit, that whether a professional career also covers aspects of, let's say you work in a certain domain, that domain is your entire ambit, right? It's not your team lead or your project manager or the company that you want to switch to. It's much more larger than that, isn't it? So over there, your horizons of learning, as I also say in the video, if you want to grow at a much faster pace, at a much exponential rate rather, not even a faster pace, then networking becomes absolutely essential. And I discovered it, as we talk about the tagline of this session, is a necessity for professional success. Necessity also happens to be the mother of invention. So I, around 3 years ago, there was a point in my life where I hit upon a block, where I realized that I alone won't be able to do anything. But I hope that something could happen. There was no way, and I was working in Chhattisgarh. So how I'm going to structure this whole session is, I'm going to give examples of when and how I use LinkedIn, specifically with which people, what were the messages I sent them, what it resulted into, what not to do will come later, and then the basic tips of LinkedIn. Because if you just Google on YouTube that LinkedIn tips, for example, where they will talk about how your profile picture should be and how your summary should be, all that generic thing, that's already available. I want to give something which is not there out, not out there, because it's a personal experience, and because I think it helped me to a much larger degree than even I could have even imagined. So I'll just explain the context. I joined the government of Chhattisgarh in January 2017, and I was working in Raipur, and I belong to, as I said, in Aurangabad. Right now I'm in Aurangabad, and I was all completely disconnected from even my IIM friends, because most of them are working in metros like Delhi or Pune or Mumbai and Bangalore, most of them. Hardly anyone in Raipur, no friends to catch up. It was just work, and work with primarily IS officers. So what was my work? My work was basically to monitor the 160 schemes of which come under direct benefit transfer. So there are 20 of Chhattisgarh which do direct benefit transfer, which means directly putting money in your account. And in the first or second month itself, I realized that there is so much more that could happen if we just streamlined it, if we had a way of sharing data which would not infringe upon privacy, but at the same time, which will also decrease all the manual going back to the government and all. I had ideas, I did not know how to do it. Then randomly I bumped into Bitcoin. I was not at all interested in cryptocurrency, not even now, but I wanted to know how the technology works. Then through Bitcoin, I started learning about blockchain. Again, it was just simple Wikipedia during the lunch hour at my office in Chhattisgarh. And I realized that if we use the same technology, blockchain, which is where instead of transferring money, you can just record anything that you want to. You can have all the pros without the cons, because if you're a programmer, you can do many tons of other things. So I had vague ideas, but I had a certain hope that something could transpire. Now the challenge that I faced was, I'm in Raipur, I have a full-time job, and it's a whole 12-hour consulting assignment. I was working for PwC. And imagine that it has been, I finished my engineering in computer science in 2011. So it was already 6 years had gone by before I had done any meaningful work in computing as well. Because after that, after my engineering, I did IIM, and then I've been mostly in management. So I was also cut off from computer science. And blockchain was like state of the art. There were no books in 2017, no online courses. There's absolutely nothing. There's just Wikipedia and random things. Then I felt that, what if I just start talking with people and let's get ideas from them. And then initially I tried Facebook, but Facebook turned out to be absolutely, I don't want to use strong words like useless, because sometimes it is useful. But for me, it was absolutely useless, because nothing came out of, nothing fruitful came out. Then I had a LinkedIn profile from my IIM days, which I did not use much. But at that time in 2017, I had less than 100 connections. But I went on LinkedIn and I searched for people working in blockchain, and I actually found them. And that is some of the story that I want to share, how what happened later. So as I said, the next few minutes will be about networking through LinkedIn while never leaving Chhattisgarh. So I never left Raipur, but whatever the next years happened, things that have happened through it. So I first started sending out requests and messages, and I did not get any response. Then I realized, why would this be happening? Then on first introspection, I could immediately see that I did not have a profile picture. So then I had a profile picture, I wrote some details, because it should not look like a dummy profile. It should look like someone who is invested into the platform, so that the other person can also be interested in you. So I built my profile, I again started sending out requests. And along with the requests, you could also add a note. So that is what LinkedIn provides. If you are sending a request, it allows you to send you around 2 or 3 sentences of message. If you can crack that, if you can be perfectly precise that exactly what you are looking for, I'm not saying action points that I want to do this and this, but just say that I'll just show you an example. So the best example I have, I'll just put it at the first, Dr. Jane Thompson. So Dr. Jane Thompson, I'm just going to post screenshots of the messages that I sent to them because these are personal messages. So I can't share screenshots of their messages. So this will just be the messages that I sent them. So on September 6th, on 2017, if you could see, I sent Dr. Jane Thompson a message. Now, how did I know Dr. Jane Thompson? Simple. You just go on LinkedIn, you search for blockchain, her name comes on top. In fact, she has been named at the top 10 women in digital frontiers globally right now. So I read about her, and this message actually comes later. So initially I sent her a note of two sentences describing who I am, after which my request got accepted. And then this is the message that I sent her, that I would like to connect with you regarding a few projects we are undertaking, and I have been following your articles. Now, this is important. How do you ensure that your messages do not look copy-paste? Because you get so many spam messages, and it is so easy to identify whether a certain message is the same message that you are sending to 100 people by only changing the names, because you have to add at least one specific line. So I just mentioned about what were her articles. I read them, and because networking is not only about asking and asking, right? You also have to share. So I gave her some little feedback on the articles and so on. And then the whole, she responded actually. So Dr. Jane Thompson responded immediately. And then we started talking on LinkedIn a lot. And what happened was something amazing. So after a point, I told her that I have hit a roadblock in my project at Chhattisgarh, because this does not come under my job description. Whatever I was doing was outside my job description. My job was already going on. This is something I wanted to do out of interest. So there was not much response from the bureaucracy or the government of other departments. My own mentor, Mr. Alex Paul Menon, was perfectly supportive of this, but you needed support of other secretaries and other IS officers of other departments as well, right? So they were mostly like, if this is not something that needs to be done, or it is not a part of a government mandate, then why even bother? So that's something I was discussing with her through one of the long LinkedIn chats I used to have with her. And she said, what if I come over to Chhattisgarh and I give the presentation on blockchain? And I frankly told her immediately that I work, Chhattisgarh is probably, if you look at funding, government, one of the poorest states, actually the poorest state in India. So I told her there is absolutely no way that we would be glad to have you here, but there's no way we are going to be able to afford. She said that, no, that's not what I'm saying. So she said, she works in Australia, by the way. At that point, she was the CEO of a company, ABT Associates. Right now, she's full-time into blockchain. At that time, she was also doing blockchain out of interest. So she was the CEO of ABT Associates in Australia. And she said that she will just travel all the way from Australia and come only to Raipur just for this work. There was no other work. And I was slightly taken aback, because that's not something you would expect, right? But then she said that if you want me to give a presentation to your colleagues and your bureaucrats, I'd be happy to. I'll just come over in next week. Actually, 2 weeks later. So just 2 weeks later, she booked her own ticket, and this was all LinkedIn. There's nothing else. She does not know me. There are no mutual contacts, nothing absolutely. She flew all the way from Australia for Delhi, landed in Delhi, then connecting flight to Raipur. And she landed in the evening. And in the evening, then that's where we are having dinner at a hotel in Raipur. And I explained to her that this is almost unbelievable that something like this could be happening. And I told her that how, what she should expect. We did some basic preparation for presentations. Next day, she gave a presentation. And that is one of the presentations she gave with Mr. Alex Paul Menon. She also met many other people also. And that changed things, because now there's a whole difference between Gauro giving a presentation and Dr. Jane Thompson giving a presentation, right? And also she comes with much more knowledge and experience. And so that gave a whole impetus to the blockchain project. So now people wanted to do blockchain more and more. And now the thing was, at the same time, before I go ahead, so that is one thing, how it helped. The second was, can I get some actual guidance? Because as I said, my subject did not have any published books out there. Research was happening every single weekend. Every week you would find new articles coming forth. This month would contradict the previous month and so on. And I knew that as a single person, I am absolutely not capable enough to judge how blockchain would interact with public policy. And because I was working for the government, it was very important for me to have a mentor who would guide me that I could come across, especially when it comes to privacy and so on, if I'm going to implement blockchain. So I started reading research papers, but not just that. What I did, one more thing was, I started noting down the names of the authors. So one of those authors that I contacted many, some of them responded back. I'm still in touch, but the most prominent one among them, Mr. Edgar Whitley. So Mr. Edgar Whitley, he had written around 4 research papers that at that time, and I had read them, and I told him that as you can see in your message, I've been reading your papers and I've gained immense insight from them. And I had some doubts on which your guidance would be most illuminating. So you leave it a bit open-ended because the other person should have some curiosity, right? I'm not going to bombard him with all my doubts. At the same time, I'm not going to be one of those people who just wants to have a contact for contact's sake. But I read all his research papers. So he's a professor at London School of Economics. And he specializes especially in the arena of what happens with when policy and advanced technology interact. Whom will the technology help? Whether it will help the citizens or it will rather help the already powerful people and so on. And after this, there began a whole conversation where I used to give him ideas that this is what I'm intending to do. And he used to give me do's and don'ts, that these are the possible risks. These are the potential pitfalls that would come across. Now he's a professor, he's an associate professor, and you normally would think that why would he even give time for this? And there is no financial or monetary incentive involved anywhere in this picture, right? But yet it was happening. So Edgar Whitley helped me throughout the year. Now it not just ended there, because we had great friendship, but when the project was already done, we lost contact. Our frequencies docked. And then there was no talk for 6 months. Then because of the blockchain projects, I was invited to London. And when I was in London, I felt that why not just drop him another LinkedIn message that I'm in London. If you want to grab a quick breakfast, maybe we can catch up. I was 100% certain he will not respond. Why would he be interested in having a breakfast with me just because I happen to be in London? But again, amazing things happen if you just are bold enough to ask. So he invited me over to London School of Economics, and that's where I met him. So he gave me a whole tour of the college, and there, at the same day, he was also reviewing the PhD submissions of senior researchers. He offered me that you could sit and experience what a PhD thesis of a London School of Economics looks like. How do we review them? So I was with him the whole day, in the evening as well, when we had dinner. And imagine, all of this only began because I just sent him a message that I've read your research papers and I have some doubts. Would you be willing to help me? So this is where I also got guidance. So Dr. Jane Thompson helped me in persuasion and networking and building my own credibility. Because of her credibility, I got credibility. Edgar Whitley helped me in all the public policy matters. He's not a blockchain expert, but he's definitely a policy expert. And now, what do you want to do? Work, right? And now, I'd told my friends who are now my co-founders at the startup, Ganesh, Manish, and Aditya, that please, Manish was also with me in Chhattisgarh. He's also part of doing all of this. So Ganesh and Manish and Aditya, that please start looking into blockchain. I think this could be something really big. But none of us were ready to do the work on our own. We did not have a team. We were completely out of touch with the advancements that had taken in computer science after 2011. This was all 2017. So I needed to bond with people who never lost touch with the whole scenario and who are still working. So Genevieve Livell was one of the persons that I came across, that because she was the winner of the London Hackathon. She was the judge at the London Hackathon, and I just sent her a message that I'm exploring, and if you'd be like to work together, it would be really great. So again, this was the second time when someone from outside India came all the way from India to Raipur. Usually people don't come to Raipur in Chhattisgarh, right? But she came all the way, and I made her a judge of the blockchain hackathon. I invited her through on behalf of the government to become a judge at the Chhattisgarh blockchain hackathon, and she flew all the way from London to come to Raipur, Chhattisgarh. And I am I am giving her a traditional tribal artifact, and I learned so much from her because there's a lot of actual work that was going on. Now this was work more in terms of architecture and ideas, but I also was falling short on coding, what to do about coding. And one more thing, if you think that your relationship is only going to be about take and not give, it's not going to work. So there was a continuous exchange of ideas. Whatever insights I was getting, I was sharing them freely. Thankfully, the blockchain community is such a community, not the entire one. I'm not talking about the cryptocurrency, but the coding, the coders are especially of such a, you could say, predisposition, where they value cooperation over competition. There is absolutely no place for competition over here, because as we realize that it is million times more sensible to cooperate rather than just compete against each other. So I was falling short. This was again, I was falling short on time. I was falling short on coding skills. I was falling short on technology and everything. I had other bases covered. I had networking, credibility, guidance from public policy. Now what do you do about coding? So I messaged, so he is one of the most important people in my life right now. And only because I'm thankful that I sent him a message. I read that Larry Bates had performed the world's first blockchain project for land records in Ghana. So he's based in the USA, Indianapolis. And he has his own blockchain company. Right now the description says something different, that if on your screen, that he's a development manager at Altmarket. But back then he was a co-founder at Bitland Global. So Bitland Global was the company that he was working in. It is its own startup that he was working in 2017. And I said that it's great that you're working in land records. And I would like to have just some help in coding, because now I'm trying to do a blockchain project for land records in Chhattisgarh. I am not able to do all of the coding, because at the same time, me and my friends were learning, and it took a lot of time for us to learn, given that we already had full-time jobs. So I asked him that if you could help me and assist me in doing the coding, it would be really great. So that is how the whole conversation began first. Then we used to have this video calls all night. So I came from job at around 9 p.m. But instead of, having dinner and going to sleep, then my second part of the day used to begin. I used to have a bath at 10 p.m. and then have video calls with John Weave, Dr. Jane, Chris Bates. Most of the time, every week, Chris Bates was definitely there. And we used to talk and discuss ideas. And with him, we actually did implement the land records. So his startup, because they did, they helped us in doing land records in India. He had already done land records in Ghana. In last year, I was so happy that Larry's startup was nominated as the 50 most genius companies of 2019 in the Forbes magazine, right alongside Disney, Pixar, Amazon, and other biggies. So there was a startup, he was a David among the Goliaths, and that was really heartwarming to see. So that is the kind of environment that also gets created when you have a network where you are genuinely happy about someone's success, and also play some, we call it in Marathi, kharicha vata, just a minuscule portion in that. So that is the kind of culture that needs to be created, which is already there over the professional networks. So we are taught about all of this. How do you crack interviews? How do you crack GDPIs? How do you excel? How do you be better than other people in aptitude exams? That is okay. That is a part of it. No one's opposing that. But that is just a selection or a filtering criteria. That does not say anything about your growth. cracking an exam like CAT, entering into IIM has absolutely no correlation with how successful you'll be in life. This study has actually been done with SAT scores in US, where your entry scores, no matter how good you are at competition, it does not actually correlate directly with your success in overall life, because factors like this, networking, are not often taken into account when designing competitive exams, right? So that's one big help that I got there. And again, so this is an important quote, that networking is not a part-time or an occasional exercise. Everywhere we go, we have an opportunity to network with others. And as I said, the perfect example right now would be not be mine. It would be Mr. Abhasaheb Kale's. So Mr. Abhasaheb Kale, we just met at a common function through a common friend. We did not know each other. We just talked and he said that, come with me to Nashik. And blindly we followed him to Nashik, and that changed again my life. I'm not working in the Chhattisgarh project anymore, because it's not that I'm going to be in that networking mode only from certain places or certain hours of the day. It's just how you are. It becomes a part of you. That's how innate or integral it becomes to your personality if you allow it to be. So similarly, then what I learned was that if I ever get the opportunity to travel, because 3 years all the time in Raipur and Chhattisgarh, I used to dream about traveling. And finally, when my work ensured that I was invited to US, UK and Europe, then I'm not just going to limit myself to the structure. So I have been invited 4 times until now. So whenever I was invited, whenever you are invited by someone, they are the ones who are controlling your time, right? They will tell you that you have to give a speech, you have to do a presentation from 9 to 5 and so on. But they don't control the whole day. What happens later on is still up to you. So before actually landing in a new place, so the first time I actually went out of India was very recently, 2018. But before even booking the tickets, I started looking for people in the cities that I'm going to be invited in, who are relevant to my work. So I'll give you an example. So yes, whenever traveling to a new place, search on LinkedIn for relevant contacts, ask people out if they want to meet and discuss, and be specific about a domain area of expertise. Otherwise you'll just come out as a creep if you're just asking for a meet to a stranger. So be specific over there. So yes, so another important person right now in my life, I again came through LinkedIn. Before I went to, I was invited to US, I was already made an editor at Swiss Journal, which is the world's second largest open access journal for scientific writing. But an editor can't work alone, an editor needs a co-editor. And I was not looking for co-editors actively, I was just looking for people to meet. So New York was one place where I was invited, and I figured out that I will be free for at least a few hours. So what to do for those free hours? I just went on LinkedIn and I searched for blockchain, agriculture, New York. These are the 3 keywords I put in. There was only one result. That was Alicia Noel. And then I dropped her a message and she responded thankfully. And she also agreed to catch up and we met. And over the course of discussion and over a coffee, I realized that I'm looking at the perfect co-editor. That if she is the co-editor for the Swiss Journal that I've been invited to, this will really simplify life. And that's how it happened. So Alicia Noel and me are working daily through video calls and conferences. And probably we will come up with the world's first volume on blockchain for fair equity in agriculture by the end of this year. We would have already come up with it a couple of months back, but the pandemic and the lockdown pushed us. But yes, a co-editor. I was not looking for a co-editor, but at the same time, I was not going to squander my hours, because it's not every day that I'm going to go over there, right? This is directly a clipping from the Frontiers website. Both of us are now editors over there. And in February, just this year, I was again invited to Switzerland by 2 different initiatives. The first was the science department, and the science department held a competition that was for 7 days. And coincidentally, I was independently invited by the arts department, the Swiss Arts Council. Now the Swiss Arts Council, what they wanted me to do was to submit a research report on what could happen in art. Now imagine, I'm not an artist in that sense at all, but art and blockchain. And I said, yes, I would be happy to do because I'm going to be there in any case. So I had around 15 days worth of notice, 15 days of preparing time before I went to Switzerland. And I had 7 days given by the arts ministry where I could travel. They'll pay for all my expenses and I could meet people. But it was me who had to find out the people or the projects and come up with something. Again, it was LinkedIn. So this is just one example, but this time I used it extensively in February, where I just searched for people who are working in either arts or digital gaming. I even got to visit CERN, the Large Hadron Collider place, and where internet was born. But this is just one sample. So Angela Neifeller, I just sent her a message, and it was extremely short and specific, because I realized that if you can communicate through brevity, and if you could communicate the exact essence of what is it that you like to do, then it becomes very much easier to connect. So Angela was one of the many people I connected over the course of 7 days, and I submitted a research report. This is just one example now. I met with her, I took her inputs, and I submitted this research report to the Arts Ministry. So this was a very recent use. So although right now I'm working full time in Nashik with Mr. Vilas Shinde, with India's largest farmer collective, but I am always conscious that I will have to keep in touch with nearly everyone, because I'll give you an example. One of the people that I was in touch with, his name is Gideon Greenspan. He is the founder of a whole new blockchain platform. So you need just to be friends with people for friendship's sake. But at one point in time, when we face some problem, we realize that what to do. Usually people ask in forums that, can you help me out? Can you do this? But because there was already a networking and a friendship that was built over the past 3 years, me and my team could directly contact him, the founder directly, who directly helped us out, and so on. So it does not mean that now that my domain is about working in agriculture and ensuring that we are tracking farm produce, that the other aspects of the networking are ended. Because more often than not, it will be the journey which opens up new destinations. And that has been the whole summary rather. So what I learned, to just summarize, was that in order to get response from one person, you have to talk with dozens of people. And to get one meaningful response out of those many responses, you must already have dozens of responses. So what I showed you were only the highlights. How did the number 16,000 actually come up to be? Most of the 16,000 happened because it was me who sent out the request. I am not some famous person that people will look me up and they will, I want to add Gaurav Somvanshi. No one wants to do that. It is Gaurav Somvanshi who wants to add people. So imagine how many messages I must have sent, at one point maybe even spammed. And the people who responded actually, but then I don't remember, you quickly forget all those other things, right? If I have sent out, let's say, 3,000 or 4,000 messages, right now what I'm showing to you are the people who will be with me for a whole lifetime. And I think it was definitely worth the effort. The second, as I said, you have to be short and specific in your messages. Never ever do that, hi, nice to meet you, nice to glad you, glad to be on Connect. I mean, that's a personal opinion, because there is no reason or incentive or even curiosity for anyone to respond back to that. And if you are going to copy paste messages thinking that you've built a very smart message, it's not smart. Because if it's a copy paste message that you are sending to 20 people, all the 20 people will know that it's not something meant for them specifically. So if it was some really important people, I used to look up their work or their projects on the internet, then try to blend at least one line or two lines about that into the message. And the last is, of course, you have to keep updating your profile and interacting with others' posts. So now I'm going to give you some very specific tips that helped me. Maybe some better tips will help you out. In fact, if you want to look for these tips regarding how many words, which words should you use, what should be the type of language to be used in your profile summary and all. For that, there are very good videos right there already on YouTube at this moment also. Just Google for LinkedIn tips. So if you want to look for a clear profile picture, you cannot use your Facebook or your WhatsApp DPs over here. It has to be professional. Never ever make a mistake of wearing shades or casual t-shirts. A collared shirt and for ladies, a nice fitted top or any professional outfit that is appropriate for an office setup is good. And always smile. In fact, there is a website that I forgot to mention in the presentation. It's called photofeeler.com, photofeeler. It's very simple to remember. How does a photo feel? So if you upload your photo on a photo feeler and you go to the corporate business section, if you want to do business, then other people will vote you on three aspects. How intelligent you are, The three aspects were competitiveness and ability and likability. How likable you are, whether you're competent or not, and so on. So you can upload your photo there, get a quick feedback whether this is a really good display picture or not. And then you can also try and do that. Photofeeler.com. And the another good parts about LinkedIn is that you one common question that comes up is making CVs. And we currently do not have good resumes and CVs. All we have is just a Word page, which has a certain table of your marks, same generic skills. It's the same format for, I think, millions and millions of people out there. And that's a sad thing, especially because if all you need to do is fill up your LinkedIn profile, put in all the details, and if you click on this part, go to your more and click on build a resume, it will automatically give you a resume which will look completely professional, designed, well curated in less than 10 seconds. And this is the resume. If you don't have the time or the ability to work around Microsoft Word to build a very fancy customized resume, then instead of just, you know, whatever information people put in their resume in a simple Word format, in a Word page, instead of putting there, just put it on LinkedIn, and the LinkedIn will filter it out and convert it into a fancy resume and give it to you. So that's another use. And again, give and ask for recommendations. So this is another important part. If you have worked with someone, then send them a recommendation about how was the whole experience, and also ask them to give you a recommendation. These are just three samples of the recommendations that I already have from people, from my classmates, from people that I've already worked with in the past. And yes, so another important, most important aspect rather of LinkedIn when it comes to the professional part is, it will ask you to update your skills. What are the skills that you actually have? And not just that. So for example, the top three skills that I have on my profile is data analysis, market research, blockchain. But you can see a small number beside it. Data analytics says 67, because 67 people have endorsed me for this skill, that I know this. At the same time, it's if you could just read, endorsed by Manish Sharma, he's my classmate from IIM Lucknow, who is also skilled at this. So someone who is already skilled at a skill is validating you for a certain skill. That's like a double bonanza, right? And this will actually help you to come up and pop out in search results later on. And one more thing that happens is, there are many other ways in which you can get endorsed. So if it's great when great people will endorse you on a professional network. So right now, the largest professional network in the world is LinkedIn. And if on that platform you are getting endorsed, yes, you might have a Facebook post written about you, but if you have an endorsement on a LinkedIn platform, it will be really great. Not great, exponentially great. I'll give you an example of what again helped me to boost my networks and credibility. So around 2 years back, this is not a part of the series that I'm writing right now for Lok Satta. This is a much, much older article. So it was a one-time article that I wrote for Lok Satta. Right now I'm writing for Lok Satta on Thursdays. Every Thursday I write it. That is different. This was 2 years ago. And I had written a small, you could say, review of a book. The name of the book was Blockchain, The Next Everything by Stephen Williams. Okay, all good. The article received generally good feedback and it was forgotten and so on. But then when I was invited to New York, remember? So Alicia Noel was not just the only person that I messaged. Just randomly, I felt it doesn't hurt to message, right? So I messaged the author himself, Stephen Williams, that last year, so many months ago, I had written a review about your book in a Marathi newspaper, and just that much. And I was again 99.99% sure that there would be no response, but it doesn't hurt to drop messages, right? But he did respond. He said, I'm free in New York, please come over. And he invited me over to breakfast. So we had a breakfast in New York, but that's not it. He also said that, let me also, because he's a famous author, he's a best-selling author. He said that best-selling technology author. He said, let me also push you on my LinkedIn network. So he shared one of my posts and he just wrote one line. I love the way Gaurav thinks. That helps more. That helps a lot, actually. So that's one more example over there. And with that, I'd just like to say that you will have to start networking regardless of what profession you are in, what business you are in, because there is no excuse for not doing it. And this was just a personal experience of one person of who used one professional network in one specific way. I hope you also have your own story in the coming future. And with that, I'd like to open up myself to questions.
Thank you, Gaurav. It was really amazing journey, and I've been part of some of those milestones in your life, and I really seen you growing. I remember the incident when you wanted to be there in Washington for that particular conference, yes. And the way you cracked that, not only you saved your money, but you got the place in that particular conference.
As a speaker, yes.
As a speaker, and then you were with, I think, the great antivirus guy.
John McAfee.
Yeah, John McAfee. So this journey will definitely help all of us here at RA and at GSS. I'm really sorry to say, because we just faced some technical problem, and then the entire attendance was restricted to 100. So we tried background to solve the problem, but could not do so. So I apologize for that, and we will definitely make this recording available to everyone. So there are a few questions from audience, and I'll just try to get one by one. First question is from Ramesh Dada, our active RA member. What is the exact meaning of blockchain and how it is applied in agri field?
Okay.
We will keep it right. We'll take it right now, or we'll take it at the end, Gaurav?
No, I it's okay. I'll take it right now.
Okay.
I'll give a brief answer. So blockchain is just a new way to store data. It's a replacement for traditional databases. In traditional database, you can delete and update information. The only difference with a blockchain is that once information goes inside a blockchain, you can only add to it. You cannot delete it or edit it. Because of this aspect, that you can be completely rest assured that the data that you're seeing in front of you was not tampered with after it was input into the database. This trust opens up whole new channels. It began with Bitcoin. Because of this trust only, people started doing financial transactions. And what blockchain intends to do using this property is to bring trust to the whole aspect of digitizing. So don't just digitize, also add the value of trust to it. In agri sector, what we are doing is we are providing three kinds of transparency to the consumer as well as the farmer. So I said that we are printing more than 20,000 QR codes, and it goes on each and every food product. Once you scan the QR code, the consumer can see all the food details regarding what pesticides were used, what was the sowing date, harvesting date. The second is know the farmer, all the farmer details regarding the farmer photograph, the GPS location of the plot from where it was harvested. And the third most important is know what happens with your money. So if you're paying 100 rupees to buy let's say half a packet of grapes, half a kilo of grapes, then you will see out of those 100 rupees, for example, 41 rupees or 61 rupees is going to which farmer, the exact name of the farmer and all the farmer details. What is happening with the rest of the money? How much is the transporter's cut? What is the cut of the processing unit? What is the cut of the retailer? So this is the project that we are using in agri field. But if you are asking for blockchain in agriculture, then the answer is much larger because we are building a whole volume on it. Yes. So
I think Ramesh, we can definitely have a very interesting session on the entire journey there, and that is maybe a subject of 2 hours. But we will request Gaurav and entire Sahyadri team to be here. From Pramod Gaikwad, there is one question: what other tools you use like PhotoFiller on LinkedIn?
Okay, so PhotoFiller is one tool that I found it useful for ensuring that a photo is good. The other is, to be put it very bluntly, what LinkedIn doesn't directly give is a spell check or a grammar check. So if you could just ensure that the content that you're putting forth is grammatically correct and you're not using too many hard words only to sound impressive. So over there, the tool is not any specific tool, but rather your friends that you should definitely get your review corrected from. So there are three important things in your LinkedIn profile. The first is your profile picture. It is really important. It's on Facebook, on WhatsApp, it doesn't matter what your profile picture is, but over here it has a certain meaning. The second is the headline. So for me, the headline is rather simple: CEO and co-founder at Emartic Innovations. But initially I think it was much better, so I keep changing it, where it was blockchain evangelist / supply chain agriculture / editor at Swiss Journal. So it depends. So your headline will summarize what you do, what you are. And the third and most important, because now that you've caught attention, what do you want to do with it, is the profile summary. So the profile summary is, I think the word limit over there is close to around 600 to 700 words, which is really good. So the profile summary must be all as simple and sweet about what is you like to do, what you are currently doing, and just one line about your hobby to just humanize it and not completely sound like a professional robot over there.
Great. There is another question from Aishwarya. Yes. Insightful session, Gaurav. How do we ensure that more recruiters view our profile?
Yes, thank you so much, because I think I missed a very important aspect, which is this question itself. So recruiters, it's the one and most important tool that you need is keywords. There should be certain keywords within your profile. So for example, if you're into marketing research, then words like survey and data analysis, outreach programs, this should be there somewhere in your profile. The second is, the most simple way that recruiters will filter you out is what skills you have already put in your profile and how many people have you validated those skills. So ensure that you are correctly filling in the skills portion as well as spraying all the keywords throughout your profile.
Great. I think I'm just trying to get some of the important questions immediately for yes, LinkedIn, sir. Because there are so many questions on blockchain and other aspects. One good thing, one important aspect, Gaurav, I just wanted to ask you. You being a startup guy, I think you have made more than 2 startups successful. So we have a business forum, and a lot of my business friends, in sense RIT alumni who are very active in business, their own private business, they are here. So what you would like to advise them, how to effectively use LinkedIn there also?
For the startups, I think it becomes even more crucial. Because if
startups as well as even for said business, I think we have a businessman over experience of 15 years, 20 years and like that.
Yes. So over there, the most important aspect is, can you join forums which are already there on LinkedIn? So I am right now a part of at least 30 to 35 forums, which are all specific that the future tech, advanced tech, blockchain for this, blockchain for that. And over there, you will meet industry leaders who are actually interested in having conversations about what can happen about the future. They will not talk about what, how to grow my company and all and all. They will be completely focused on ideas. And if you could connect with them, so if the initial connect happens organically and not, you know, completely business-like, then it has a whole new meaning. The other most important part is there are so many people, and I'm not one of them, who will regularly post on LinkedIn regarding all of their professional experiences and whatever insights they have. So if you could identify those people, that yes, I know that he, that's a great person. For example, I'm following a person called Venkat Rameshwaran, I think, who writes brilliantly on agriculture. So what I will do is I will ensure that I will read each and every of his posts and I will comment there. So the thing is, what you do on Facebook for friendships, if you do the same thing on LinkedIn, it has a much more exponential returns for you in terms of personal growth as well as professional growth.
Great. I'll request if any task force member or anybody who wants to ask any direct question, please raise your hand. We can unmute you, or otherwise we can get going on this particular discussion. One important thing, Gaurav, what I feel is that, like you rightly pointed out, number one, getting endorsements. Number two, when you follow somebody or connect with somebody, just go through the entire screen of LinkedIn. If you're viewing it on, say, laptop or on mobile, you get a lot of other people of the same profile or same nature or from same domain, and you'll surprise that these engines which are used at LinkedIn are really powerful. And yes, you have to just click on follow or connect with them, and then immediately after that, if you even follow their company, and you get a lot of great inputs, because most of the companies, most of the corporate houses globally, they publish their latest research, their latest information, their latest initiatives on LinkedIn. I think that's my personal experience, and you get to know a lot of good things, great white papers or free stuff, which is normally not readily available if you really go and Google it directly. Maybe you get condensed search here. We have one question from Mr. Paresh Adwani. Paresh ji, 1 minute. I'm just trying to unmute you. 1 minute. Can you unmute yourself, Jasip? Yes.
Yes, Paresh. Sorry for coming in late. I just want to know, there is a module called Sales Navigator, okay, in LinkedIn.
Okay.
And how to use the Sales Navigator, and it is just giving 20 in-mails. So how can I increase the quantity of these in-mails that I can buy?
Okay. So for the in-mails, I had used the premium profile for only 1 month, because it was rather expensive. It was around 2500 per month if you want to use the premium version, which is allowing, I think, 40 in-mails. So I have not used the Sales Navigator. Whatever I've done is through direct messaging to people manually.
Okay. So I think they have, Paresh, lots of paid versions, right from 1200 to 2500, 6000. But what I understand is that if even you don't know email ID of some specific person, you are allowed to send messages to them. And that's where
very short, that's what it is. You can connect to a lot of people, but you know, just they limit you to only 20 emails. 20 is hardly anything. One company is sending 20 emails and whole packet of 6,900 is lost into it. So missing on to some technique, or it is that expense. What is it?
So email comes into play. For example, if I'm saying that I, as a LinkedIn member, do not want messages from anyone outside my friend list, LinkedIn will not allow that. Because if you want to connect to me and you are not in my list, but you have the premium version, then InMail is something that you can message to anyone. So that is the power of InMail. That is why they ask for money. But what do you do if you don't want to pay for InMails? So there are two ways to do about it. The first is, if it is allowing you, sometimes it allows you to add a short note, then within two sentences, you have to grab the attention in such a way that they will send you the request themselves, which is how Dr. Jane Thompson connected. You can't connect with her without email directly. The second is, most of the time it will ask for emails if you have zero mutual connections, right? So one simple trick is that if you go to the person's list, you add people who are already there in the person list, you increase the number of mutual connections. If you have at least one mutual connection, you can suddenly send them a direct message, because depending upon the person's settings, right? So it will just take certain amount of patience, but I think growing going organically helps a lot. And in email, I've realized that now I'm in a position where I get emails from people, but most of the time I ignore them, because these are by paid agencies who will just have a simple software that any person who has CEO or any CXO in their title, just bombard them with the spams. So emails are unfortunately getting used for that.
Okay. There's one question from Kaushik. Kaushik, I'm trying to unmute you, but I'm not able to do so. Can you unmute yourself and ask your question? Manne Kaushik. I think meantime I'll then shift to Ramesh. Ramesh, you want to ask, you can unmute yourself. Yes, Ramesh.
Yeah, Gaurav, it was very fantastic and informative session rather. And thank you very much for your valuable time and valuable guidance. It was an effort from ABBA and our team to bring you on this platform and know the informative. My simple question is, see, I have around 3,500 followers in LinkedIn. Okay. And being a common person, see, I'm into business. I'm always active in LinkedIn. But what will be your guidance to keep them continued? Basically, my followers are there, but I'm not able to analyze them. Okay. What is the analyze basically tool, and how to keep them interacted continuously? That is number one. Number two, what I have seen in some of the countries, if we would like to connect, and I personally agree with your statement of saying hi, hello, nice to meet you and all, it does not really helpful in professional these things. If you direct come to the subject, but I had some on the contrary, responses I got. When I got into direct subjects, I could not able to get the responses. So how can you guide on that subject, please?
Okay. So for the first part, I think that is something I'm learning from my own network. So there are some alumni that I have from IIM Lucknow. For example, Shantanu Deshpande is one name, and Dadan is Rohan Shah, which have, I think, followers in close to hundreds of thousands, lakhs and lakhs of followers. How they do that is in two ways. Either you have to be extremely useful for, if you can share, let's say, HBR reviews, Harvard Business Review, if there's a good article that has come out, are you sharing it? Are you interacting with people? And if someone is commenting on your post, you have to reply to them rather than just like them. This is not Facebook. If someone is making the effort to even give three words of compliment, you must have the courtesy to respond, because that also ensures that other people can see that you are not just someone who is just sharing links but are eager to respond. And that takes time, because I have seen these people, my own alumnus, who build their entire businesses basically by doing this same thing. Such heavy engagement on LinkedIn platforms, such extremely heavy engagement. And right now, they don't have to leave their homes for anything. They need a VC, they need a new client, they need to hire people. Everything happens at the touch of their buttons. The second, as I said, sir, it's a very fine line between being specific and between being dry, as I would say. So to give you an example, when I wanted to message to Miss Angela Neifeller, I just felt that because she works in art, if I'm too specific with her that I'm coming up with a research proposal and I'm on a research trip and this and that, it might not work. So I just said that I love what you do. You're into art and all. And I'm also coming there for a trip. Maybe it could, pan out well. So you have to be very flexible within a certain spectrum. It's not that completely specific and completely friendly. You will have to adjust that. And that's a personal guess. And there is no, as I say, Ramban upay for this. It's just that if you think that you are not getting responses from 5 people, the brute force method is to send messages to 50 people. Because at least the laws of probability will always be on your side. That's what I felt in 2017, that yes, I don't think that more than 5 people are going to help me. So I felt, but in order to reach those 5 people, I'll have to talk with 5,000. So that is the attitude with which I went ahead. Just going with laws of probability and brute force.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Great. There's a question from Anushka Chaudhary. Anushka, can you please go ahead?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, I'm a student of computer science and I'm still doing my BTech. So I have seen some of the courses on LinkedIn ID. So I want to know about, like, those courses are helpful in getting that internship or something.
Okay. Anushka, what you probably saw was people sharing courses from other websites like Coursera, Udemy, Udacity, or Code Academy on LinkedIn. So I'd rather answer this in the reverse way. If you do some certain courses from Udemy or IBM, which are for free, some of them are for free, Udacity at least, many are free. Then what they give you is an option to add the badge and certification on your LinkedIn. So you don't have to write about it. A badge will get created directly on your LinkedIn profile, because many of this, not many, each and every of this mass open online courses, MOOCs as we call them, Coursera and all of them, they have tied up with LinkedIn. So if you are doing a certain certification and if you're sometimes paying for it, they will give you an option that it will directly pop up on your LinkedIn profile. So that helps recruiters much more faster while doing internships. If you're looking for internships, I think Internshala, I hope you're aware of that, internshala.com, which is specifically for internships for students, that would be a much useful website.
Sir, even some of the courses are provided by the LinkedIn premium pack. So I want to know about that courses, sir.
Okay. For that, I have not tried any of them. So I would not be the right person to answer this question.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay. So is there any question from anybody? You can please raise your hand. Otherwise, I'll request Professor Mahesh Pisa to present vote of thanks. Any question? Manzoor? Manali? Rohit? Yes, I'll just unmute Professor Mahesh Pisa. Sir, please unmute yourself. Yes, yes sir, go ahead.
Okay. Good evening to all my friends. This is Professor Mahesh Pisa from Mechanical Department, RIT. It's my great pleasure to offer vote of thanks for this program jointly organized by RAH and GACS, Global Association for Corporate Services. Friends, up till now, most of all had registered in the LinkedIn info platform. Our understanding was limited up to its professional network for finding the jobs and business opportunities. But beyond that, how to make effective use of this platform was elaborated and explained very nicely and in a simple look-ahead manner. Definitely, RAH members, RIT family, RIT faculties, students will make the effective use of this professional network for personal branding and for developing their professional life. I express my sincere thanks to today's resource person, Honorable Gaurav Somavanshi, CFO and co-founder, Emertech Innovations, for sparing his valuable time from his busy schedule. As per commitment, he delivered in spite of his family problems. I am thankful to him on behalf of RAH. I am also thankful to GACS for their joint association with RAH, and this association will be further continued for such professional development programs. I am also thankful to all RAH task force team for taking effort to organize and coordinate this program with our slogan, Network is Network. And last but not least, I am very much thankful to all attendees of this program for their overwhelming response. Once again, I am thankful to all those directly and indirectly involved in making this program successful. Thank you to all.
Thank you,